First session in Drupal Camp London.
Right.
Yeah. So thanks a lot for joining in. I am actually here to talk about Drupal 8 with Cache and BigPipe. Looks like a big line, but yeah, it's quite simple. So who is me? I am actually Nikhil Sukul. I am a senior Drupal architect working in 5G solutions. Overall, I'm working for about 17 years now in IT, big time. 8+ years in Drupal, already 8+ experience in Drupal and maybe more and long years to come. So let's dive in. Have you read this phrase, around the world in 80 days? Everybody might have read this book, right? So what actually people require is, they want their site to be around the world in 8 seconds. Is it? Not now, maybe 3 to 4 years back or 5 years back, everybody wants their site to be loaded in less than 10 seconds. That's what their aim was. And then after that, they said, let's load our site in less than 5 seconds, around the world in 5 seconds. And now the era is that people say we should load the site around the world in 3 seconds. Was it really true? We need to load the site in less than 3 seconds. Well, if you see the survey, they actually say that 40% of users abandon a site that takes more than 3 seconds. So it's absolutely critical that our site should load in less than 1 second or 2 seconds based on our mobile browser or based on our desktop browser, because nobody ever cares about if it loads any longer. So what to do about it? So initially, when we had such kind of problems, when BigPipe or any other technology was not there, conventionally or traditionally, how we were actually doing it. So what we're doing is, we're actually saying, load my page faster. So everybody was saying, please load it faster. They don't know how much faster, but they wanted to be make it faster. They wanted to be very, very fast. As soon as I see it on my mobile, it should be fast. It doesn't matter 3 seconds or 4 seconds. I don't care what my network speed is. I don't care what my ISP provider is, but I want to make it faster. So what should I do? So what I started off with, backend. So the first thing that people realize is, okay, we have to make the page load faster. So what is our technology is all about? We have a backend and we have a frontend. So what is backend is? The backend can be any technology, right? It is a series of servers, maybe Apache, maybe Nginx, maybe any other server in the backend. Let's optimize our backend. Optimize in such a way that is actually rendering or getting the content to the browser very, very fast rate. So if your backend, which is source of data, which is going to the browser, is optimized, it will throw the content in a faster rate, and then my front end will be faster. So the first thing what we did was, or what we thought to did was, we first actually optimize our backend. So what do you optimize our backend for? There are a lot of ways to do it, and there are various ways to optimize backend. Apache was actually having modules for, you can actually gzip the files and throw it to the browser, the network latency will be less, and then you can get the files in a very, very straight way, faster rate. Your HTML will be, you know, parsed and shown in a faster rate. So there are various ways to optimize backend, and that was a traditional approach when somebody says, I need to page load faster. Being 16 years, I also did that initially. I was very, very enthusiastic to dig that. I actually optimized the backend. See, your front end is very fast now. I have optimized the backend. Everything is coming from backend very, very fast rate. So you can actually see in very fast rate. But that's not going to help us more, because we also optimize the front end. So what actually technologies come from front end? There are many, many more, but for few, we have to minify. So we have to less our CSS files, the JS files, the images, make it minify. The size of the CSS is very small. So the size of CSS is very small, it is pushing to the browser, it is minified, and then the network latency doesn't come. Sprites, another technology which came in the picture was sprites. So images need to be sprites. So actually the front end is actually more optimized. You get the images very quickly, and then it is sprites. Now HTML5 came in the picture, we get offline caching. So once it is cached once, then HTML5 is more of cache and all, and the page becomes loading very fast. Cleaner HTML, yeah, so definitely we get rid of tables, we came on to div, and now we are going for HTML5 tags. So our HTML is very, very smaller. Rather than a view source which is keep on loading and loading and loading, we have a view source which can easily, we can see it. So smaller code, less byte, faster load. This was one of the few of the things which it does for front-end optimization. But what exactly the end user really wants? What do you really want? If you are an end user, you're a non-technical person. What you really want is that as soon as my site is loaded or as soon as my page is loaded, I want to interact with it. So I want those parts of the page to be loaded first, which I want to interact with it. I don't want to have a white page saying keep on loading because I can't do anything about it. But as soon as I have something on my page, which I can click on a button and do some interaction, I am happy with it if the rest part of the page is not loaded yet. Right? So this is our experience. This is what we require. This is what end user require. Performance versus perceived performance. So optimization of backend, optimization of frontend, all nerves down to only one conclusion, that where the users are clicking and what exactly they are seeing, what part of the page they actually wanted to load first. And if that load first and the rest of the part is still loading, they don't care right now. They can see the part of the things what they're really interested in and they can use it. And that's what Facebook did. That's what actually the technology of Big Pipe came. But before Big Pipe, there was another one, lazy load. So I have these talks in various conferences about Big Pipe, and the first question comes in the mind of everybody who is very technical and working for a long time in the industry. Lazy load is there. Anybody is familiar with lazy load? Yeah, most of the people are. So lazy load is actually a technology in which you can actually have the page loaded, and then from AJAX request, rest of the part of the pages keep on loading. It's AJAX request. If lazy load is already there, then why we have this Big Pipe thing going on? And lazy load is good enough for us, right? There will be some problem with lazy load. That's why Big Pipe came in the picture. So what is the problem in lazy load? It has few drawbacks. So traditionally, lazy load was actually created for images, traditionally. Though people have hacked it and people have created lazy load for content also, we have GitHubs for that. If you can go and check it out there, you'll find it. And secondly, the most importantly, it fires separate HTTP request per lazy load, which means that subsequently it increases the number of connections for the backend server. For the backend, it's new connection. For the front end, guy is just a Ajax which is coming on. For the back end, it's like keep on hitting for each and every connection for that particular part of the page. So it's like if I have a site which is having millions and millions of users, and I have a lazy load on top of it, think about the performance of the page. I mean, if one page is having 10 lazy load, that means 1 into 10. You have to multiply that performance impact. So that's where the lazy load was having a problem. The lazy load was actually having a problem with respect to AJAX. But it's not that lazy load doesn't work now. It is still working. People are still using it. But we have a better thing than lazy load. So what is the solution of that then? Introducing Big Pipe. This is what happens in Big Pipe. So in Big Pipe, you have one HTTP connection for the whole process. So as you can see here, you have a normal processing structure, normal page. You have AJAX scattered loading, which you can say lazy load, and you have a Big Pipe. So in Big Pipe case, you have only one HTTP connection, which you can see, which can actually pushing the data to the page. So the processing cost is less. Normal structure anyway, there's no problem, but you can see the processing speed, processing cost is same as normal page here. And we're using Big Pipe on top of it. So what exactly is Big Pipe? So Big Pipe was founded by Facebook in 2009. So they actually give that particular phrase as Big Pipe. It actually uses something known as pagelets. So what it does is actually create sections of the page. Anybody here who have used Joomla before? So in Joomla, there was a particular ocean where you can actually have pagelets, not pagelets, they say portlets. So in Joomla or in other Java technologies, there's a portlets. You can create portlets, small sections of the page. That is for the backend technology. We can actually create in Joomla the portlets and then the portlets get loaded as a part of the page. In Drupal, we know those backend things as blocks. So we have blocks on the page. And that blocks we actually load. But what I am talking about here, or the big pipes that you're referring to, is page legs for the front end. So what they are saying is, you have a page in front of you, and I will divide the page in small pieces, known as pages. So generic idea was that several execution of stages will be sent, will be inside the web browser and the servers as pagelets. So let me define what pagelets is and how it works. So in a layman language, what pagelets does actually. So it does whatever lazy load kind of thing does. It actually loads the most important part of the page first. And the time taken of the page, of the entire page, is actually the same. That's why I said perceived performance. So if you actually go to the inspect element and click on network, you'll find the load page time is actually the same. Doesn't matter if using big pipe or not. But what happens is the relevant part of the pages, or the sections of the pages, are actually loaded first, because that's what technology big pipe is all about, and actually that is done via pagelets. So this is an animation which was created for big pipe. So as you can see here, big pipe caching, header, products, these were loaded first, and then it started loading the other things. So see, this is the standard page. It is loading the entire page, whereas in big pipe caching, the header, products, which are the relevant sections, are loaded first. And this is the favorite one. I think you might have seen yesterday if anybody have attended the session. So here, I think I need to click on it. So personalized low cacheable, this is Drupal. This is personalized low cacheable, personalized low uncacheable. And then you can go down and check. This is the comment section. It's personalized, fast, and uncacheable. This is section. In traditional approach, if I clicked on it, what happens? And this is the big pipe section. So 0.5, 2.5 seconds, the relevant sections are loaded. In traditional, it just keep on loading because it has to load the entire page. The total amount of time is 6.50, which is the same. But actually, what happens is you have the time difference the same, but the relevant part of page are loaded first. So see, in traditional, if I have cache also, it's 3.25. And in case of big pipe, it is again 3.25, but relevant part of the pages are loaded first. So how big pipe works? Okay, so the big pipe works in all these 7-8 things. So actually the big pipe works in page generation process in several stages. It first do the request parsing, which is a web parser passes and sanity text checks their HTTP request. Data fetching is happened from the web server. So all the first three things are happening on the web server steps, and then from 4 to 8 is happening from the browser steps. So data fetching is happening from the web server. It fetches the data from the storage tier. You can say it's a database layer or any other layer you can think of. Then markup is generated for the HTML. Then network transport happens from the client layer. So it goes to the network layer. The transport is the response is transferred from the web browser, web server to the browser, sorry. Then in the browser, what happens? The CSS started downloading, because as soon as the requests come to the browser, the first thing will happen is to start downloading the assets, the CSS images and all. It will do that. Then the DOM trees construction will happen on the browser, which means the CSS started, now the HTMLization and the DOM structure will start elementing on the browser itself. Then the JavaScript will start loading, which we need to parse and we need to run. And then the JavaScript will execute. So if you think of this way, it will be something like this. So on the server side, you have request parsing, data fetching, and markup generation. And on the client side, you have network transport, CSS downloading, DOM tree construction, CSS styling, NGS download and execution. Now, if you think of in the big pipe perspective, each pagelet must go through all these stages sequentially. But it's each page, each particular pagelets are actually works simultaneously. So every pagelets will have all these things to be done, but all will be done simultaneously. So the effects to the browser is actually very, very good, because you are able to see what exactly you require, though every pages will have all these stages to be done. So let's talk about big pipe in Drupal. Okay, so how to use big pipe in Drupal? We have a module, big pipe, I think this was done by Fabian, and it was actually done by Wim. And Fabian is the one who is a contributor there, so thanks a lot for him. So we actually have to enable BigPy in Drupal. And also, we need to enable internal dynamic page cache module along with it. Okay, so let me first talk about what happens in BigPy in Drupal. So BigPy in Drupal module is actually dependent on the very, very good module of caching, which is available only for Drupal 8, which is this internal dynamic page cache module. What it does is actually it allows you to prioritize the content which is more dynamic and which is not dynamic. You are not the one who are prioritizing it. You are not the one who is getting a screen. Can I load this content or can I not load this content? This is done by Drupal itself. So there is a render caching API which is done in Drupal 8 specifically. It's an awesome API. What it does is actually analyze the page and find out what is the most dynamic content, what is the least dynamic content, what is the static content. Based on this render cacheable API, this particular dynamic internal cache model works. And based on this concept, BigPy actually takes data from here. So BigPy, whenever they ask us to install, they also say that please install internal dynamic page cache along with it, so that the BigPy will work seamlessly on that particular ground. And there is another module. If you open and see the Drupal 8 core, you have internal page cache. Now, internal page cache is actually for anonymous user, if you see the description. But so it is not dependent for BigPy. So it's not required that when you're using BigPy, you need to enable it. You can enable it for anonymous user anyways. That works well for anonymous user's experience. Okay, so how BigPy works in Drupal? So what happens is it actually turns rendering into placeholders. So without BigPy, Drupal will use single flush. I think we already saw that particular slide of GIF where we have standard page. It is single flush, and we have another page of BigPy which is actually loading the relevant content. So without BigPy, Drupal will use single flush strategy for replacing the placeholders and will not send a response until all the tokens are replaced. So it will keep on waiting, and when all the tokens are replaced, then it will send the response at one stroke and you will see the entire page. But whereas in BigPy, you have initial page load because you have placeholders. Now how the placeholder will come in the picture? Will actually come in the picture with respect to render arrays API, which is already available in D8. So when you have BigPy enabled, it also knows that based on the render array API, what are the sections of the page which are more dynamic. So those kind of pages will be flush out, and then the placeholders keep based on that placeholders will be starting load, and then you will see all the parts of the page. So the cheap parts of the page will be load first, and then the expensive part of the page will be load. So this order is not decided by us. This order is decided by the render API of the Drupal, which is already available there. Okay, so let me push to a demo. So this is my site. I don't have any BigPy here. And this is my site with BigPy. So if you see here, so standard normal devel generated page, nothing much is there. If I go and on the performance, nothing is aggregated. Let me do it here also. Sorry about it. Still loading. It's a pretty old system. Bear with me. Maybe of 90s. It doesn't take parallel process, it seems. Okay, so come on, 42.39 seconds. 1969 or 19. Okay, let me click on the home page. This is without Big Pipe. Bear with me, I don't think it will be the exact seconds thing. This is just for demo because I don't think my system is good enough to give you the exact speed, but yeah. So, without Big Pipe for this page, it's actually saying 16 seconds. It's too bad. Okay, I don't know what will happen here. It will be should the same, but let us see. So I will go to the same page again. It has the same database, same content and everything. The only thing is additional is Big Pipe module enabled, nothing else. Everything else is the same. So let me click on that, or click on network. So it started loading the page first, and then it started loading the other things. You can see it's coming everything in the background. So the small part of the page was started loading already, and then it started loading the rest of the part of the page. So it's actually 18 seconds, so it's even worse than that. But what I wanted to tell you was is that on the right side, what you see here, when the pages start loading, this was still loading. This was still loading the content. Where in that case, when this page start loading, it was that particular right side section was already loaded. So what I did here in Big Pipe, let me remove this now. Okay. So let us see in the model section. Yeah, so this is D8. We have modules here, lots of modules. Internal dynamic page cache. This is enabled. Internal page cache, it is also enabled, but this is actually for anonymous users. And where does Big Pipe? Here you go. This is Big Pipe. What I did additionally, I did nothing additionally, anything else. I just downloaded the module Big Pipe, enabled it here, and I enabled one more module along with it, which is required is this one, Internal Dynamic Page Cache. That's it. These are the only two modules enabled. Rest everything remained the same. I didn't do anything else for this. But still, I was able to get some kind of performance boost as perceived performance boost in my page. Because in a normal scenario, this page will be loaded and along with it, this particular, all the sections will be loaded. In case of Big Pipe, you will have internal dynamic cache plus Big Pipe. It will actually allow you to have that perceived performance effect. Okay, so let us see what happens in the module. So this is the module of Big Pipe. in Drupal. So how many folders it has? It has JS, bigpipe.js. It has some source. Definitely, if once the guys who already know Drupal 8 might be knowing what exactly this structure is. And you also have some test. And you also have bigpipe. So in bigpipe, you have info. So let's start with info. What is the dependency of bigpipe? Any dependency of bigpipe here? No. What happens in YAML? Yes, so there is a dependency in libraries for bigpipe.js. This is being modified with respect to Drupal. It is not that particular standard bigpipe.js which is used by Facebook. It has a lot of properties with respect to Drupal, which is done by Wim and Fabian, thanks to them. So which is actually based on our render API thing, so that we can actually render the things properly. It has dependency on jQuery anyways. You can see that. It's already in the code. And it has routing.yml, which is actually going for a path, which no JS and no cache and those kind of stuffs are there. So if I go to a module file, or let's go to the JS file first. So in the JS file, you see it's very much specific to Drupal. The functions is actually creating an anonymous function, which is actually having a Drupal setting. And then we have a placeholder replacement. So which this is what I was talking about. That in BigPipe, you actually have a technology for placeholders. So first thing what they will do is the pages will actually have the page placeholders, and the placeholders will be replaced by BigPipe. But what happens in traditional manner, in lazy load or any other manner, the placeholders are done in a single flush, traditionally by Drupal. So all the placeholders will be done at once, and then the page will be rendered. In case of BigPipe, this is a JS file which actually does it based on the priority. So it actually see the content and based on that and do the parsing and everything. So this is a particular JS module file, JS file which is being used. They process the document also, and then based on that, the BigPipe process happens. There's a time interval also set there for BigPipe process. It is actually 200 for now. And then you have jQuery and all the other things. So in the module file, just a quick thing for module, we have a BigPipe help and we have BigPipe attachment things there. So there are a lot of sessions configuration which require in BigPipe. So that's the way BigPipe actually works along with it. So yeah, this is what BigPipe is. Any questions? Yep.
Is there any configuration? I appreciate you don't need to. Is there anything you can do to specify which order things come in?
Not right now. As per the BigPipe current version, there is no configuration, zero configuration for now. Mm-hmm. And what I have seen as per the render API, it actually done by automatically to see what is the dynamic content order is and how big is the dynamic content is. It is done by render API. There's a link in my slide. You can actually go inside and have a detailed look.
Okay.
Actually, we can have a different session for it. It's so big to understand that. But yeah, so they have a particular way of doing it. They have cache tags and cache APIs and all. You can actually go through each and one of them and then you can understand how exactly they do the ordering on it. But BigPipe is actually taking on top of it on that. Yeah. Any other?
Yeah. Is there any known limitations at the moment? Are there any issues for just using this and installing it?
I haven't installed it in a corporate site yet. I have more of a sandboxing thing I have used yet. In one of my corporate site I have used it. Till now I haven't got any downside till now. But yeah.
I've got one more question.
Yeah.
The method that it goes and then retrieves the bits that are ready,
mm-hmm.
is that just a standard AJAX call, like a standard asynchronous call to the server to go and get it when it's ready?
Looks like, because as per the code, it looks like a standard AJAX call, but if you compare with lazy load, they say it's just one HTTP request, mm-hmm. rather than having separate HTTP requests for all the AJAX calls. So if you drill down the code of BigPipe module, you find that AJAX is actually there. So it's not doing AJAX at all. It's actually doing it. But the way it's actually doing it is actually pipelining it. So at one stroke itself, it is actually getting on from single HTTP request rather than having multiple of it. Yeah.
You know how he's doing that, how he's managing to do that, how he's piping it.
So there's a BigPipe.js file I told you, I showed you already. That is a core of the Facebook one. They have modified it on top of it to make it a Drupal wrapper on top of it.
Okay.
And that is having that sequence to how to do it. So the magic is actually coming from that JS.
Right.
And then Drupal is actually on top of it. The rendering is coming from Render API. So all the things follows like that. So it's like a process.
Right. So it's some clever new technology.
Clever new technology, definitely. An awesome one. Yeah.
So if I understand correctly, then you've got the single request going from JS to the backend.
Yeah.
The backend is returning everything in one one response, and then the JS is intelligently
rendering it. Yeah, how to render it. Yeah.
So is it possible then that if you had one particularly slow part of your backend, that
mm-hmm.
could delay everything because you still wouldn't get your response back in time? So in some situations, it might make sense, perhaps, let's say, to have two requests, not lots like the original lazy load, but perhaps two requests, one for the really slow backend,
I truly understand that if that is required, or that may be possible. We have
okay.
to see about the backend also.
Yeah.
So this is the ideal scenario in which the front end is optimized, but definitely we need to think about backend anyways. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, it's kind of asked part of my question. The big part is that could you implement the big part on normal Ajax requests? So, you know, Drupal makes Ajax requests anyway. Like, say you hit a view pager and it goes to the next page. Could that be another option for having big
I think
to package up all the very slow stuff?
So the question is whether we can implement big pipe of normal Drupal Ajax request. This is what I think is, anyway, big pipe will be in the core in Drupal 8.1.
Mm-hmm.
I think they will be doing that maybe once they will be doing it in with respect to Drupal. Maybe that is the next step which we are doing. Right now we have to additionally install this module and do it for it. But maybe it will be in there in the view source or in the views in the core itself, in the Ajax. Because anyway, internally it is anyway calling the Ajax. The only thing what is happening is pipelining the request at one
yeah.
time and throwing it at once. Yeah.
Is it only beneficial for logged in users? Or does it work hopefully for anonymous users as well?
Yeah, so for anonymous users, anyway, we have internal caching system. There's two modules on
yeah.
it in Drupal.org.
Would you, if you only had anonymous users, would you
yeah.
bother with BigPipe at all?
I can use a BigPipe. I can check it out in that, but it's better experiences for authenticated users. And we have a trouble authenticated users in Drupal. We know
yeah.
that already for a very long time. This is a very good solution on it. Yeah.
I'm not, my HTTP 2 isn't particularly good, but I believe it kind of features the idea of pushing.
Uh-huh.
I wonder if there's been any movement in the direction of, from the front end, we send our request to the back end, and then the back end gives whatever it can as quick as it can towards the front end, maybe prioritizing, the stuff you want quicker.
Excellent question, but I don't believe I have an answer for it right now.
Yeah.
But yeah. Any other question?
You were saying you need to have enabled the internal dynamic page cache.
Right.
Is it because it's not dependent on a module, is it a strict dependency?
No, it's not a strict dependency, but what is being assumed is that the render API actually have the priority things in there. So when you enable BigPipe, and if you enable that particular module of internal dynamic cache, in fact, if you do the readme of txt of BigPipe when you are enabling it, it actually recommends that.
Mm-hmm.
It says that when you have to use BigPipe, please enable this module. Because that particular module has all the render priority, which actually does it, and then the BigPipe works efficiently. So that's why we have to enable it, and that's what we see. Anything else? Anybody else? Yeah, thanks a lot. Thank you.